Okay, we have three lectures in the morning session. And the first one is by Claudia, a very interesting topic of extreme learning machine. Okay, Claudia, you can start slowly.
Yes, I start slowly. So
can you see? Yeah, just, yeah.
Okay, I guess you can see my screen. So, and yeah. As told, this is my second lesson in this school. Again, this is a topic that we are developing at the Department of Physics in Rome, and in particular at the University Sapienza, that also contain the Institute for Complex Systems. And people mainly involved in this talk today are Davide and Giulia. Davide is a researcher in Sapienza, and Giulia is now a postdoc in the group of Bob Boyd in Ottawa. So in my first lesson, I have outlined that you can do two different investigations within machine learning and related. That is, you can do combinatorial optimization machine learning task. So I have discussed a first kind of machine that you can fabricate in your lab with very simple hardware. And this easing machine is good for doing combinatorial optimization. So the goal of this lesson is to show that you can do also other things with the same device, and in particular that you can do more conventional machine learning tasks by using a simple spatial light modulator. So this is my the title of this my second lesson, which is extreme learning machine. And I also add by waves because I want to link this topic on the with the topic of the so-called wave computing. So I will introduce this wave computing, and I will try to explain what does it mean and in which sense it is related to neural networks. Then I will describe this very simple device, which is the extreme learning machine, which is a good starting point for working not only in the lab, but also in modeling these devices. And finally, I will just mention two new directions that are emerging from the marriage, I would say, between photonics and electronics, which are new devices that use all what you can use to do new things beyond conventional machine learning. Because when we use photonics, not only we can speed up or replicate the typical devices that you can do with a computer when you do machine learning, but you can do something more using light with respect to electronics. So let us start with Fourier optics. So what is Fourier optics? Actually, Fourier optics is something that was considered to be starting with the publication of this book. So various authors says that the Fourier optics was born from this book, which was due to is a very famous book by Goodman that was published in 1966. So in this book, there is the clear connection between optics and mathematics, and in particular Fourier transform. So we know that propagation in optics is equivalent to Fourier transform, I mean linear propagation. So we can easily compute Fourier transform by optical propagation. And this is what we mean with Fourier optics, that is using optics to do a Fourier transform. Now, if we realize that we can also do machine learning with optics, we can talk about machine learning optics as the evolution of Fourier optics. So now we can do a lot more other things with optics, not only Fourier transform. So we can think about talking machine learning optics. However, there is some problem in this kind of view. And the problem is that Fourier optics is not equivalent to a neural network. So linear propagation is not enough to do a neural network. because linear propagation is class P, while in general neural network can tackle with much more complex computational tasks. So we need the detectors and modulators to do machine learning. And so you can think to machine learning photonics, which is the photonics that perform the tasks of machine learning, which I think it's a very interesting research direction, as you probably have seen in this school. You probably are realizing that machine learning is changing the way in which we do devices in photonics, but it's also through the opposite. Photonics is also changing the way in which we are doing machine learning. So to have a more concrete idea of what I mean when I say that waves compute, let us look, for example, to this very nice paper that was published a couple of years ago, more or less. In this paper by Sanjuri, Fan, and co-workers, they consider different signals that comes from samples of speeches. And these signals are used to generate a wave, and the wave propagates in a material which has a certain refractive index distribution. This device can be trained in order to classify the different signals. This means that we design the refractive index distribution in this device in a way such that we can have different outputs at different points. For example, this signal can output here, this signal can output here, etc. So this is a classifier. This can be made some kind of speech recognition task. And it is trained in the very same way you train a neural network. That is, you start refining the refractive index distribution in a way such that at the final epoch, the final training step, you will have your performance, your target performance. So you are designing wave propagation in the very same way you design and you train a neural network. So actually, this kind of papers, it is not the only papers on this subject, are evidencing a link between waves and neural networks. So you can treat a wave like you treat and like you train a neural network. So we can ask, can waves compute as a neural network? Are the two things equivalent? Well, first of all, what is a neural network? So actually, in terms of its ability to perform some tasks, from a mathematical point of view, a neural network is a universal approximator. That is some mathematical model that can represent a function of many variables, any function. So a neural network is nothing, and machine learning in general is nothing but that a colossal feat. So you have a function that you also do not know in its mathematical formulation, and you can use a neural network to fit any function. And this is the origin of the power of machine learning. And this relies on a theorem, which is sometimes referred as the representation theorem, which has been developed by different authors. This is one of the most famous, famous papers. Actually, this theorem states that you can approximate any function by using a non-polynomial neural network. And so if we are trying to establish an equivalence between waves and neural networks, actually we can ask if waves are also universal approximators. So can we use a wave propagation to do the same kind of fitting that we do by a neural network? So in other words, do we have a representation theorem for waves in terms of mathematical background, in terms of mathematical foundation of these equivalence? Actually, this is what we reported in a recent paper in 1 year ago, in which we clearly show the condition in which a wave is actually as powerful as a neural network to perform a fit. So in essence, to perform the same tasks that you do with neural networks. In general, however, this is not true. In general, a wave is not a universal approximator, but there are certain conditions in which this holds true. So first, we can consider just linear propagation. Is linear propagation a universal computing device? No, because if you want, for example, to approximate an arbitrary function, you cannot do this by a linear propagation, because you will only be able to approximate a linear function by linear propagation. So you may consider linear propagation and detection. Linear detection, what is linear detection? Is a detector which is linear with intensity, which corresponds to a quadratic nonlinearity. So also in this case, you will not have a universal approximator, because by a quadratic nonlinearity, you cannot fit an arbitrary function, a cubic function or a more complex function. So you will need at least linear propagation and nonlinear detection, and I will explain in a moment what is nonlinear detection. This may furnish you a non-polynomial nonlinearity. So this kind of linear propagation plus nonlinear detection is actually something that is equivalent to a neural network in terms of its mathematical properties, its mathematical ability to fit a universal model, that is to fit any arbitrary function. And then you may also consider the most general case, you can consider nonlinear propagation and nonlinear detection. In these two cases, this is a system that actually exhibits a non-polynomial nonlinearity. In these two cases, you can use a neural network, a wave, as you use a neural network. So what is nonlinear detection? Well, if you look at this image, in this image, you have the different points have different intensity. But if you look here, you realize that different points have the same intensity. So in this region, your detector is saturated, your camera of your phone is saturated. So we know that CCD cameras and photodiodes are linear in the intensity only in a certain range. But in general, any light detection that we use in our lab is actually a nonlinear function of the intensity. And this is the typical nonlinear function of our detectors. We have a linear region, but we always have a saturation region, as you can see here. And this is quite interesting because this is perfect for doing neural networks. So we already have in our lab the kind of device that we need to have the non-polynomial nonlinearity that we need. So we can just use a camera and that's it. We do not need more than that. So using such a nonlinearity, we may try to build a deep neural network in the laboratory, for example, for doing some classification task or similar task. But we realize that this is not an easy story. So if you look at the typical model of a deep neural network, you have weights, then you have nonlinear detection, then you have other weights, and so on and so forth. So what you need is to train precisely all these weights, which correspond in practice to a precise control of the refractive index, which in photonics means a very careful and high precision fabrication at the nanoscale. So this can be very complicated in practice. And then we have another problem, which is we cannot cascade later layers, because if we use a nonlinear detection, we cannot cascade a layer, because after the detection, we need again to transmit light. So this is a problem that is typical also in telecommunication. When you have repeaters in a fiber optical link, you need to get the signal, then amplify and re-emit the signal. So in principle, we can do these things, but actually it's a very complicated story. So this is not the best that we can do in our lab to perform computing. But maybe we can do simpler things which are enough powerful. So to give you an idea, this is a recent, very famous paper which was dated 2 years ago. In this paper, they design different layers. They 3D print different layers. Then they launch light in this device. And then they detect the light. The light goes through the different layers. It is scattered. Each layer is 3D printed, so they have precise control of the refractive index of this system. And this layer can be designed in a way such that the resulting device works quite a good way in for fashion classification. So this kind of device can work as a neural network in practice with these detectors. So they obtain more than 90% of fidelity for the MIST. The MIST is the typical benchmark dataset that you use in neural network. In any starting example of neural machine learning, you typically deal with the MIST. But to reach such performance, they need to print 5 layers. Now they use a 3D printing. 3D printing does not give enough resolution to work at optical wavelength. Indeed, they use a terahertz laser source, a terahertz source, which means 1,000 microns for wavelength. So using such a long wavelength, they can actually print with the required precision these layers, so they can fabricate this device. But this is not a deep neural network, because there is no nonlinearity from one layer to another. So from a mathematical point of view, this is just a single matrix. There is no multiple layer in the deep neural network sense. Indeed, this is a diffractive deep neural network, which is not the same of a deep neural network in which you have nonlinearity. So this device is working, but it's not the same model as a deep neural network. It's something different that I will discuss in a moment. So it is a different computational model. It is a different paradigm. And it is a paradigm that we can implement in the lab in a way much easier with respect to what we can do with a deep neural network. So we discussed this point in this paper, in which we actually show this representation theorem for waves. And actually we have discussed the following. If you consider this kind of system, that is a system in which you have a linear encoding at the input. So this is your encoding layer in which you put your input data. Then you have nonlinear propagation here, and then you have detection here, or eventually you're going to have a linear detection and linear propagation and nonlinear detection of both. In this system, you can train just the final weights in the final layer, which is a linear layer. And this device is universal. This device can work as a conventional neural network, in which we replace the conventional layers with wave propagation. So wave propagation under certain condition is equivalent to having a layer of a neural network. So this model here is actually a wave equivalent of what is known as the extreme learning machine that I will detail in a moment. And so by using this kind of system, you can demonstrate that actually a wave is equivalent to a neural network in terms of computing power. So once we have this mathematical background, it means that we can use a nonlinear fiber optics, for example, in time or in space to perform computing. Or we can use also nonlinear optics, including spatial and temporal effects, to perform computing, or also other waves. For all this system, there is this equivalence. Equivalence means that you can train the system to do the same. And this nice idea was also implemented in this work that Dimitri Psoltis has described a couple of days ago in this school. In this model, they consider a spatial light modulator that encode the input. Then they have a nonlinear multimodal propagation. And then they have a detection. They found that this experimental device actually perform well as typical deep neural networks. And there is a mathematical reason because of that, because a nonlinear wave is actually equivalent to a neural network in terms of its representation power, in terms of its ability to fit a very large and complicated function. So this is quite interesting, but to do this experiment, you need a nonlinear fiber, you need a pulsed laser, you need a sophisticated and very stable optical device and a lot of computing to perform this. We think that this very interesting device is quite intriguing for many physical reasons and also for many practical applications. But if you want to start doing these things in the lab, maybe you can use something quite simpler. And in particular, you can do the same. I mean, you can do this kind of wave learning tasks by not using a fiber, by not using a pulsed laser, and even without any sample. So you can start from scratch with a very simple setup. And to explain this fact, let me describe with more detail what is an extreme learning machine. So the extreme learning machine is, as told, a different paradigm with respect to deep neural networks, which is a name that is also including other similar paradigms, like random projection, kernel machine, Fourier network, reservoir computing. All of them are actually the same idea, but we like a lot the name extreme learning machine, but you can find similar result in all with different names. And this idea is so simple and so good for photonics that recently this company in Paris have made available this optical computing device. So this is an optical computing device that you can put in your rack in which you have conventional computing system, and then you can buy this optical computing device to accelerate certain tasks. So this is one of the first, in my knowledge, products that are now available for making photonic computing. So this is a clear evidence that photonic computing is entering into computational systems. And it is quite exciting to see this kind of outcome. And this kind of system is based on the extreme learning machine or random projection model. Actually, the idea is super simple. You do not want to train the system. You do not want to train precisely the refractive index in a kind of device. So if you do not want to train, you may try to resort to use many, many nodes. So we want to use a lot of nodes. And then if we have non-polynomial non-linearity, we can perform a machine learning task. In a certain way, you can think to this idea as follows. You have a very complex wave dynamics. This very complex wave dynamics actually performs all the computations that you want. They do all the combination of the inputs. So your goal is just to pick properly the output in order to choose the computation that you want among all the others that are occurring. It's quite similar to quantum computer. You have a parallel system that performs many computations. If you are good enough to choose the computation that you need, you obtain and you train the result. But this is doable with classical physics. So you do not need quantum physics with all the more complicated story. So let me discuss the model. You have an input, and this input can be, for example, different images. Then these images are combined by random coefficients. And then you have outputs. These outputs are nonlinear function of what you have before. And you, if you properly combine the outputs, you obtain your target. This is the leading idea for the extreme learning machine that was published, say, 15 years ago, more or less. And it was also quite in parallel, it was also developed by other authors like random neural network or similar. I want to enter a little bit more in the mathematics because it is quite interesting to map this math to optics. So, but it is quite simple. So we can do this in a few lines. So we have an input, which is our matrix. Then this matrix is processed by a random matrix, which means we are using random coefficients, which is actually another linear transformation with a linear matrix. And then we take some kind of nonlinear function of this resulting transformation. In general, we do not have just a single input. We have different input. So we have a data set. So we have one image, another image, and so on and so forth. So we will have different inputs. And seemingly, we will not have one single output, but we will have different channels in output. So for any input matrix, we can have different channels, different points in which we pick the outcome. So actually, this system is just a matrix, which is for any input datum, the number of output values that you get. And what you want is actually taking these values and combining them in a way such that they give your target result. So you want that this computation provides your target result, which can be your target output. And the idea is super simple. You just linearly combine this transmission matrix element, and you fix the linear combination in a way such that you obtain your target output. So at the end of the day, it's just a linear regression, a linear system that you want to solve. And your system is all determined by this matrix, which is actually due to the internal structure that you do not train. What you only train are the output coefficients. So can we do this in a biophotonic device? Yes, in general, it's quite simple to do this kind of model. So in our photonic device, we can use a spatial light modulator to encode the input datum. Then we have the propagation and through a random medium, because we need the random coefficient. So this will be a multiple scattering medium. And then we have the propagation in air to form our image. So as we are using the spatial light modulator, again, our mathematical model will be quite similar. So this is the model for our optical setup. We have our input image. Then we put this image as the face of the spatial light modulator. So this is a phase encoding of the input. Then we propagate through the random medium and through the air to reach the camera. So it's just a linear propagation. So this may be represented by a matrix. And this linear propagation is actually the propagation through the random medium and the propagation through air. So we have M, which is the propagation through air, which is just a linear Fourier transform that you may also represent as a matrix, as you probably know. And then you have a random matrix, which represents your random medium, which can be a multiple scattering medium, just a piece of paper, for example, or some foam or whatever you want to use. And then we have detection. Detection for us is actually the image on the CCD camera. And so we have not one single point, we have many different points in this CCD camera. And each of these points is actually a different output channel. So this will be channel one, this will be channel two. So we have as many points, as many pixels we have in the CCD camera, which is a huge number of points typically. And this is our output channel. And as told at the beginning, our CCD is not a linear device. Even if you think it is linear, it is just an approximation. It is a nonlinear function of the input. And because we know our CCD camera actually saturate at a sufficiently high intensity. So as you may see, it is quite straightforward to implement this extreme learning machine paradigm in photonics. And so we started from this idea, and we started doing this in the lab. And the setup is super simple. You just have a laser, which is a continuous wave laser. Then you have a spatial light modulator, and then you propagate through some medium, which will be your random medium. It is diffusing light here, and then you form the image. So we started studying the performance of this device, and our goal at the beginning was to try to understand which is the best medium that we can use to make this kind of neural network working. So we, at the beginning, were very optimistic because we found that it was working with some diffuser here. Then we also tried with a nonlinear medium, and it was also working. So we tried with different diffuser, and it was also working. So the problem was that it was always working. So we did not understand why this device was working so nicely. We tried to figure out if different material could improve the performance or things like that. But at the end of the day, it was always working with good performance. So one day we removed the random medium, and it was still working. So this was really puzzling, but actually this device was working without also the random medium. That for us was difficult really to understand, because as I told you, you need a random medium. And actually our final photonic extreme learning machine was just the spatial light modulator and the target image. But this could not be working, because if we look again to our simple math, if we do not include the random medium, again, our model is the following. We have just the input image. Then we take the phase of it. We use as a phase in the phase modulator. Then we propagate without any random matrix. And then we take the detection by using our nonlinear detector. So in this case, the propagation is just the Fourier transform. And we take our nonlinear detection. So we were arguing, so is this model also working as a universal approximator? To test this, we actually implemented in a computer. So instead of using the experiment, we implemented this model in a computer. And indeed, it was not working. So this model was not working in the computer. So this was not behaving like a neural network. So this is a wrong model for our experiment, because our experiment was working. So we found a model that was not working while our experiment was working. So we are missing something in this model, which actually must be present in the setup. And it is not surprising that this model is not working, because there is no randomness. And randomness is quite an important ingredient also from a mathematical point of view in the model. So if you have a model that has no randomness, it cannot work as a universal approximator. So somewhere in our device, there must be some kind of randomness such that we introduce some random matrix before we do the detection. And obviously, there is only one place in which this randomness can be present. And this place is the spatial light modulator. So we have the idea that the spatial light modulator introduced unwanted noise. And this is quite not surprising, because any spatial light modulator as first a finite precision, and second, when you buy it, you have a calibration sheet which tells you that you have to add a certain phase to the image in order to proper work. So you have a phase correction in a spatial light modulator that you must include always. And this is precisely this phase correction that introduces a random component in this system. Then also there is some fluctuation and some uncertainty in your system. So your spatial light modulator has always some noise. And this noise is small enough, it's very small, but it works. It enables to introduce the small amount of randomness that you need to make this system working. So in other words, when we use the spatial light modulator as an encoding layer, this introduces an embedding, that is, this introduces a random component to your input, which is enough, combined with the nonlinearity of your camera, to make it working, which was really surprising to us. And it is for free, because anytime that you use a spatial light modulator, you have this randomness. So it does not affect the speed of your device or the size or all the other, or other stuff. It's quite trivial, but I think it's quite instructive. It can give us a lot of information on the way we have to consider these kind of things. So our very super simple photonic extreme learning machine is just a spatial light modulator, propagation and detection. And the training is just done by determining this beta coefficient. So to be more concrete, for example, let us look at this kind of problem. We have to classify the minced data set, which is a certain number of images in which you have different digits that you want to classify. Then you take your input matrix into SLM, but the SLM add this noise contribution, so that at the end of the day, your input datum will have this additional random phase that you may also control to optimize the device. So you have a different input data set. You have this embedding matrix, which is due to the SLM. Then you propagate, you form the image. And this is the image. Notice that it's saturated because we are working in the nonlinear regime of the detector. You can take different pixels in this image. And then you can combine with proper linear coefficients that are readily determined by the data set. So you can train the system by determining this linear coefficient in order to perform different classification tasks, for example. And these are various tests that we did. It works quite well with the MIST. We obtain 92% of accuracy, which is comparable with the examples that I've shown you, but without using any 3D printing, without using any TERS laser, without using anything, just using a spatial light modulator. We also tested with mushroom of Super Mario Bros. To classify them, and it also worked. We also tested with the Abalone dataset, which Abalone is this sea snail, this monster here. It's a very funny data set because you have different parameters of these monsters, and then you want to predict the age of each of these, and it works. We can training and test, and all of this is done by a single SLM. So let me tell you what I learned from all of this story. Actually, what I learned is that trying to implement a deep neural network in the lab, it's super cool, but maybe it's not needed. Photonics gives you much more degrees of freedom with respect to electronics. So just a change of model, just a change of paradigm can enable you to perform new things. So and now, so I have in mind what follows. So we generally think that machine learning is aimed to replace human action, for example, to translate a document. So people often claim that we do not need to do theories, we do not need to do models, we just use data and a good neural network and we are set. We can close our physics book. I think this is not true at all, and I'm sure that most of you will agree with me, because I think, on the contrary, that machine learning is stimulating a lot of new interdisciplinary science. So it's a sort of brain stimulation. It's not for stopping our job, but it's for improving our job. And so we can consider machine learning as a new tool that we have to invent new ideas and to put together new ideas in a very interdisciplinary way. And to give you practical examples of what we are trying to do with this idea, let me just conclude talking about what I think are hybrid neural networks and what I think are hybrid neural network engineering. So these are new devices that put together all the power of conventional machine learning and photonics. And for example, and these are something that we are trying to invent, and there is a lot of interesting possibilities. For example, you can combine the photonic extreme learning machine and deep neural network to do new tasks. In this paper, we use this kind of approach, that is a photonic system and a conventional deep neural network, to do cryptography. This is a paper that we recently published with Fradalocchi, who is in the Caos University, Adam Fleming, and Larry Falco at St. Andrews. And this is about generating secure keys that are based on physical unclonable functions. So if you have a cryptographic key, someone can steal your computer and can clone your key. So there is interest in having something that is not clonable. And I hope you can see this image. For us, the unclonable key is just a piece of matter, a piece of aerogel. An aerogel is a very light material made by many atoms that are arranged in a random way, but it is nearly transparent. And so we use this kind of sample as an unclonable physical key. So you can open your electronic wallet only if you have this key, this physical object. But of course, you need to pass from the physical object to an electronic key. So we use this scattering medium, this sample, inside a photonic layer. This photonic layer provides an image. This image goes as a seed, as an input to a conventional deep neural network, and we train the deep neural network to produce different keys. And these keys are actually unclonable because they depend only on just one single sample. And they are also truly random because we certified that they are truly random by using proper routines. So in this way, we are using both photonics and the deep neural network to perform an intrinsically secure system, even without claiming into account quantum effect. This is purely classical. Then I want to show you another interesting example, what we call a living optical random neural network. So this is another paper in which we try to commit together idea of photonic computing and also biology, and also conventional computing. You do not have to understand all the details. I just want to give you the framework, and then you may check the paper if you like. In this case, we use in the photonic extreme learning machine a sample of a real tumor. That is an assembly of cell. This is a glioblastoma tumor. It's an assembly of cell that is replicating, that is changing with time. So it is a living ensemble of cells that is put in our photonic machine, and then it grows with time. And we can train the machine in order to provide information about the growing of these cells, and also about, for example, the effect of some chemotherapy in the sample. So we can use this photonic neural network in order to get information about the dynamics of this system. Seen from a perspective of a neural network engineer, this is quite a fascinating device because we have optical layers, which is the laser that goes through the biophysical system. Then we have biophysical layers, which are actually made by your cells that replicate and change in time. And then you have electronic layers, which is the processing of the system. So it's really an hybrid system. And we tried to demonstrate that this kind of system is quite interesting for making biophysical investigation. We call the system a random optical machine, and we compare with other techniques. And this kind of approach is label-free, non-invasive, time-resolved. It has many, many interesting features that are relevant for biophysical investigations. So I want to finish here. Let me summarize my two lessons. We actually have realized two very simple computing devices, which, however, are competitive with some of the best and most expensive devices that you can find around. And we are starting combining photonic and electronics in order to invent new applications. And this is the end of my second lesson. And super final thing, let me advertise this conference. This picture that I've shown is taken from Hawaii. Hawaii was a place in which we did the nonlinear optic conference 2 years ago. As you may imagine, this year we cannot be in Hawaii and we will have only a virtual conference. But if you're interested to nonlinear optics, please consider to apply to this event. So thanks a lot for the attention.
Thank you, Claudia. It's a nice invitation. Virtual conference in Hawaii.
Yes, Hawaii.
I think it's amazing lecture, extreme learning lecture.
Yes.
So, I got this message. I'm not sure if it is right message or I got it wrong, but it is still extremely stimulating. Basically, what I got is that any nonlinear optic system, if it is not good enough, can be used for computing. So if there is noise enough to create randomness, that at least it is worth to try.
Yes.
It's amazing.
Yes, the challenge at the moment is understanding what is best. And I'm sure that there is no a simple answer to this question. I think that any different application has a different neural network or photonic neural network. And this is an engineering problem, actually. So engineers are those that choose the right model for the proper application. So physicists may demonstrate that the model is universal, but at some point you have to make a real application. And at that time, engineers, I think, come into play with their vision, their knowledge, and so on. This is my personal view.
But observation that your device is working because of noise, because of randomness, is amazing. I think it's intuitively, quite.
Yes, but it has a deep mathematical origin. And let me say a little bit more on that. When you demonstrate that the model is universal, you arrive at a certain point to, if you look at the mathematics, in which you have to demonstrate that some matrix can be inverted in some sense. So this means that all the rows of this matrix must be independent in general. If you have randomness, this is the case, because if your matrix is large and it's made by random numbers, it will be always something that you can invert. On the contrary, if you do not have randomness, at a certain size, it will not be possible to invert it. So randomness has a very interesting mathematical...
It's a sort of regularization. Yeah.
Precisely, yes, that is the point.
So I should not abuse my role of chair. So if you can look at the...
Yes, there is one question. Yes.
Yes, and I believe more questions will come. Yes, one more.
I see that using this method...
I encourage participants to ask questions. It's really exciting. Okay. please.
So it's not 100% accurate, that is true, but I don't know any 100% accurate model. But when you want to test some machine learning model, for example, you consider the MIST dataset or other datasets, the best it's 98%, 99% that you reach with the huge deep neural networks that takes months to be trained. So you can improve the accuracy by, for example, considering larger systems and these things in general. But consider that I've just shown the super simple system that you can do. So if you want to reach 100%, the only thing that we can do is try to engineer the system, consider larger system, and eventually it may be that some kind of randomness is better than another randomness. So you can try different random seeds and see if the performance increases. So to me, this is still open. So there is no simple answer. The final performance is strongly dependent on the data set that you consider. And there is another argument here. We do not necessarily need the 100%. There are many applications in which you can limit to 95 or 96%. Also, we are not 100% as human being. We do not classify things with 100% precision. So if we are inspired by our brain, we do not need to have 100% accuracy in general. But so I don't think that you will never reach 100%. You can only reach 100% if you need all your data. If you have all your input data, so you have no generalization, you can learn all the data. But if you learn just a certain amount of data and you want to predict some of them, I don't think that you will ever reach 100%. But of course, the system can be improved. You can try different media. You can demonstrate that, say, fiber optics is better than spatial nonlinear optics or things like that. So it's an open issue how to improve the performance.
Okay, so, there are two more questions from Oliver and Steve.
Yes, stop me if time is short, but I have a few minutes, you see. Yes, the second question is precisely the same. So you have just you have an optical computer plus a linear classifier. So do you increase performance by optics? No, you do not increase performance by optics. You do the same by consuming less energy and with a much cheaper device. So I think that this is the optics can be relevant and can be also fast, because hardware is improving. Maybe Daniel, after we talk about some new hardware that may be relevant, I don't know, he's working with FastSLM and things like that. So I think that optics can do the same, but it's much more interesting for this kind of reasons. How much does this round up the? I can say that it is as performant as a silicon classifier, but I mean based on these sites and this, so that we obtained the same performance as the electronic counterpart. But as told, we do not reach the 99% of GPU and large system. So but at the moment, using an electronic system, maybe you can learn this dataset in a much accurate way, but it costs a lot in terms of time and money. So the second question is about, with an echo-nested network, you can improve these reservoir models. Yes, once again, we did the simplest thing that you can do. So we just used the linear regression and an optical hardware. You can do a lot of things to make this behaving much better, and you can use more sophisticated learning. So there are and hyperparameter tuning. So there are many parameters that you can use to optimize all the stories, and that is true. I just wanted to show you the simplest. This is the simplest story.
Okay, two more questions. Yes, and yes, Daniel is already.
Yes, and see, yes, stop me. So, can we call this?
No, it's all right. You have several minutes.
Yeah. No rush. I have stuff to do.
Can we call this system a deep neural network? No, we don't. We cannot call this system a deep neural network because there is. It's not the deep neural network model. It's an extreme learning machine. We call this wave layer neural network or wave neural network. It's something different. And of course, you can combine, as I've shown you, you can combine a wave layer with more conventional layers. So what is when you do this, you obtain a sort of hybrid system. So I like to think to one wave as a one layer. So we use one wave layer and one real layer. So it's a lot of fun, I think, thinking to this.
Okay, questions are coming,
so try to answer them. Give me a random face that can be useful. If entry. Okay, so the randomness is needed to learn. So if you want to, if you do not have the randomness, you cannot train your system. So I try to shrink a bit the answer, but you can cut me. So if you have randomness, you can train the system to do different things. If you do not have randomness, you cannot train for doing one data set with respect to another. I hope this is enough for the moment. The size of the input image is the mist. So I say 64 times 64 or 8 times 8, depends on the resolution that you have and then we tried the mist, we tried the data on the Avalon. So different data set have different input image. I guess the mist for the simplest one is just 8 by 8. Moving to leader PXC system for a so you can improve a lot. You can use more sophisticated spatial light modulation and things like that. Diffracting neural network in a chip, yes, you can integrate in a chip. It depends on what kind of chip you have in mind. You may have an integrated chip with waveguides, and that is an issue because the scale can be small. So with waveguides, you cannot go at a large scale. But for example, I've shown you, we talked about the Lighton company. They realize a system which is like that, just a small stuff. It's a small, like a cellular phone, more or less. And this is put into a conventional computing, optical computing device. So it's something that can be integrated in nowadays available computer clusters. Okay, so I think
exhausted questions. So. Yeah, I suggest that if you have questions, you